Good to be in the house of the Lord this morning to worship our triune God. And as we begin to do that, let's listen to these words that he's given to us in Holy Scripture. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving, and let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a king above all gods.
Thank you. good morning and welcome to worship this morning. If you're a visitor, very warmly welcome to worship with us at 10th today. There's a welcome centre in the front. If you needed any advice as to what ministries we have, please ask the folks there and they'll be glad to give you that information. This Sunday is the beginning of the week in which the church has historically celebrated the ascension of our Lord Jesus to his throne, the throne of David, throne at the right hand of God, from which he reigns over history and over the world for the sake of his church. And with that in mind, we're going to read from Daniel chapter 7. We're going to stand and sing the doxology. We'll then pray and then we'll sing our opening hymn, which is number 2, O Worship the King. So let me read from Daniel chapter 7, where Daniel has a vision. He says this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, there came one like a son of man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom, one that shall not be destroyed. Let's stand. Almighty God, our Father, and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, you have exalted to the very highest place your only begotten Son, our Lord, and have given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess him to be Lord. He has ascended, and from there he reigns over history and over the world for the sake of his church. Grant that we, Lord, in heart and mind, may dwell with him in the heavenly places and today in the heavenly realms, bless and praise his glorious name, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen.
be seated. It is awesome to sing the praises of our God, is it not? Well, it's a custom here at 10th Church to read through the Psalms and to do so responsibly. And so today we come to Psalm 15. If you're unfamiliar with the Bible and not sure where that is, you'll find that on page 453 of your black church Bible there. I will begin with verse 1, and then you will respond with verse 2, and we'll read this short psalm responsively. And then following our psalm reading, we'll all rise together. We'll sing the Gloria Patri. That's an ancient hymn of the Christian faith. And then using the words that are printed for you in your order of worship, we'll confess our faith together with the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let's now read together the living word of the one true God. O Lord, who shall sojourn in your tent? Who shall dwell in your holy hill? Who does not slander with his tongue, and does no evil to his neighbor, nor takes up a reproach against his friend. Does not put out his money at interest, and does not take a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things shall never be moved.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated.
Let's turn to the Lord in prayer. Our great God, we do give you gladly the worship that is due to the great King over all creation. We have gladly come here as your people whom you have created, and your people whom you have redeemed. And we worship you and give you praise that we may worship you through our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, as your word says, who can appear before you? Who can dwell on your holy hill? Who can come before your sanctuary except he who walks blamelessly and does what is right? And our Father, we do pray for that work of your Spirit in us, to sanctify us, to cause us to walk blamelessly, to walk in your ways, to speak the truth. And our Father, we must confess before you, for you know even more so than we, that oftentimes we have failed to be blameless, that we have broken your laws, that there have been times in which we have not spoken the truth. There have been times in which we have spoken evil, spoken rudely, hurtful things to our neighbors. There are times in which we have avoided doing what would cause us harm because we were more caring about ourselves than caring about our neighbors or about your own glory. So we confess these things before you. But all the more then we give you praise for him who did walk blamelessly upon this earth, who did what was right, whom spoke the truth, and indeed whom spoke and acted to his own hurt, indeed to his own death, that we might be saved, that we might have the guilt of our sin washed away. We give you praise for our Lord Jesus Christ, whom exchange for our rags of sinfulness and gave to us his robes of righteousness. Truly, this is a worthy King, one to be worshipped. We give you praise for his great victory and give you thanks that even now he is at your right hand and that he intercedes for us, his people. And it's because of him that we come to you in confidence, knowing that you hear our prayers and lift our petitions before you. We pray, our Father, for your kingdom to continue to spread throughout this earth. And we pray for our global partners who have left even from among our own congregation to go into other parts of this world with the gospel of Christ. And we pray for your blessings, your protection upon them, and all the more that you would answer their prayers to be fruitful in their labors. We pray for our sister churches in North Africa, those areas in which they worship you in peril to their own lives. And we pray for the work of our global partners there. Pray for your protection and again for fruitfulness in their work. Father, we pray for the students at Daystar University in Kenya, where our partners Don and Faye Smith work, and we pray, Father, that you would enrich their work as they carry out the work of the gospel, as they disciple young believers, and pray for good, strong leaders to come forth from their labors. We pray for our partner Boon Chu, for his pioneering work in Southeast Asia, for the work that he does going among villages in the jungles, and we pray for your protection of him, wisdom for him as he acts and provides oversight for many churches. And we pray just for your blessings upon him and his family. We pray, Father, for the ministries taking place here in the Philadelphia region. We pray for our own Acts Bible studies to take place on Thursdays in homeless shelters and for good fruit to come forth from those labors. We pray for Harvest USA, and particularly for John Freeman, and pray for healing for him with his back injury and facing possible surgery. We pray, Father, for others who have been ill. We lift up Eric Wallid, rehabilitating from surgery. We pray for Wally Jones, who has suffered long and continues to suffer with various illnesses, and pray for your strength and mercies upon him. We pray for your comfort for Leslie Thompson and her family and the loss of her mother. And our Father, we give you thanks for our daughter church, Grace and Peace. And we pray for this young church and give you thanks that already that you have blessed them and that you have brought those who were lost into your kingdom because that church has been established in that neighborhood. We thank you for our brother Jonathan Olson, who served so faithfully here on this staff and heeded your call, and because of his love and his zeal for the gospel and for his neighbors, again has established a witness in a needed area. We pray that you would provide for them financially as they seek larger accommodations because of the blessings that you have placed upon them. And then, our Father, we lift ourselves before you, we who are in this sanctuary. And you know the needs that we have that are within our hearts, our minds, the things we worry about, the things we are excited about. We pray, our Father, that you would minister to us, that you would use our own pastor in the proclaiming of your word to preach clearly your truth to us, that we may be convicted as we need conviction, comforted as we need comforting, lifting up where we need that lifting up, so that we might honor the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. If you turn with me now in our scripture reading to 2 Samuel chapter 6, and you'll find that on page 258 if you're using the church Bibles, page 258. Let us hear the word of God. David again gathered all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people who were with him from Baal, Judah, to bring up from there the ark of God, which is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, who sits enthroned on the cherubim. And they carried the ark of God on a new cart, and brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was on the hill. And Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark. And David and all the house of Israel were making merry before the Lord, with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. And when they came to the threshing floor of Nacon, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him down there because of his error, and he died there beside the ark of God. And David was angry because the Lord had burst forth against Uzzah. And that place is called Perez Uzzah to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day. And he said, "How can the ark of the Lord come to me?" So David was not willing to take the ark of the Lord into the city of David. But David took it aside to the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. And the ark of the Lord remained in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told King David, "The Lord has blessed the household of Obed-Edom and all that belongs to him because of the ark of God." So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. And when those who bore the ark of the Lord had gone 6 steps, he sacrificed an ox and a fattened animal. And David danced before the Lord with all his might. And David was wearing a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the shout of the horn. As the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, the daughter of Saul, looked out of the window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord. And she despised him in her heart. And they brought in the ark of the Lord and set it in its place inside the tent that David had pitched for it. And David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings before the Lord. And when David had finished offering the burnt offerings and the peace offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord of hosts and distributed among all the people, the whole multitude of Israel, both men and women, a cake of bread, a portion of meat, and a cake of raisins to each one. Then all the people departed, each to his house. And David returned to bless his household. But Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, "How the king of Israel honored himself today, uncovering himself today before the eyes of his servants, female servants, as one of the vulgar fellows shamelessly uncovers himself." And David said to Michal, "It was before the Lord who chose me above your father and above all his house to appoint me as prince over Israel, the people of the Lord. And I will make merry before the Lord. I will make myself yet more contemptible than this, and I will be abased in your eyes. But by the female servants of whom you have spoken, by them I shall be held in honor." And Michal, the daughter of Saul, had no child to the day of her death. May the Lord add and bless the reading of his word. I'm delighted to be back and delighted welcoming everyone here for worship, and particularly those who may be worshiping with us for the first time. And you're going to find cards in the pews in front of you, or they're to the sides of you in the balcony. I encourage you to fill those out. You can place them in the offering plate, but even better, I encourage you to take them back to the Welcome Center that's in our narthex, where we have church members who would love to greet you and answer any questions you may have about the church as well. Now, there are a couple of luncheons taking place after the service. The one is the monthly MCO, Medical Campus Outreach Luncheon. It's taking place after this service. And all those who either students or professionals in healthcare are invited to attend. Also, those who are in their 20s and 30s are invited to go out for lunch as well. You'll find information about that in the bulletin. Now, I want to encourage you as well to be thinking about the Spring Choral Worship Service that will be taking place in just 2 weeks from now. What I want you to be thinking about is what neighbors you will invite or friends whom you will invite to this concert. You'll see information about that in your bulletin. Take that card and please give it to someone else to attend. Now, I'm also just very delighted to welcome back a former staff minister, Jonathan Olson, who's going to come and share with us the work of Grace and Peace, our daughter church.
Well, those of you that know me know there's not a decaf form of Jonathan. I come caffeinated, and it is so energizing to see you guys and to worship with you again. It's just wonderful to see everybody, and I'm so thankful to be back here. I send a warm hello from the Grace and Peace family down in South Philly, also from my wife Rachel and our five children. Let's see if I can get this right. Anna Maria, Gabriel, Christabella, Angelina, Eliana. Was that right? That was right. Anyway, so everybody says hi to you guys, and it's just really wonderful to be back and share a little bit with you. I want to draw your attention, not now, but to read your 10th Press article that was written by one of our members, who she and her family joined our work early on, also to a display table back in a reception hall where we have wonderfully made postcards that you guys can take. It has prayer requests and some of our needs on there, and then also a fundraising letter that you can find back there as well. You also see some wonderful architectural pictures. We've been working with Greg and Mary Brzezinski with plans on a property that I'll tell you about in just a moment. It's been a wonderful experience for us, and so please, I'll be back there after the service as well, so please come back there if you can. I want to say thank you, and I really mean thank you. A few years ago, 10th Church released me and really anybody that wanted to go with me from South Philly into a new mission to share the gospel in a part of the city that really needed it right in my neighborhood. And you guys have given generously to us in every way, and we are so thankful. We could not be doing anything that we're doing now without the support of our mother church, so we're so thankful, and I'm very thankful to be here today to hopefully encourage you with what God has been doing and also to give you some prayer requests. You know, God's timing is always perfect. A few years ago, 10th went through a capital campaign and decided to tithe some of that money, and part of the money that would be tithed would be to start that new daughter church. We've actually learned from you in that. All the monies that we bring in every year, we tithe out of that as well so that the gospel will move forward, and so you've taught us well on that. And my heart and Rachel's hearts were burning for years to see a church in our neighborhood and really a community church for South Philly that would preach the gospel. And so 65 people, half of whom were like under five at the time, left 10th Church with us, or were sent out, I should say, by 10th Church to start this new work. And we acquired a property at 18th and Alter Streets, that little storefront property just below Washington, a very visible property right across from Chew Playground. We got the first floor there. We filled that up almost immediately. We got the second floor apartment and filled that up. And in 2 years, we've doubled in size. And it's been just very, very encouraging to see what God's done in our midst. And one of the most encouraging things that God has done in our midst is allow us to have an after-school program. Two of the kids from the neighborhood a couple years ago came into the property right after we got it and said, "Pastor John, can we do our homework?" I said, "Of course you can do your homework." And just a couple minutes later, one of the kids said, "Hey, Pastor John, would you start an after-school program?" I said, "Sure, I guess. Yeah, how do you do that?" He said, "We'll just come." Okay. Well, that was a Thursday, and Monday, half a dozen kids came, and I was there, and a couple other folks from our church, and the thing just blew up. 35-plus kids were coming every day for 2 hours to do their homework, to receive a snack, and to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And many of those kids come to worship on their own. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10-year-old kids come to worship and sit there for a 2-hour worship service every single Sunday, and then go to our monthly luncheon afterwards or go to someone's homes, and they're sort of functional orphans, as it were. And one of those kids named Messiah came up to me about 2 months ago after a worship service, and he said, "Pastor John, I'm ready." I said, "For what?" He said, "To start the relationship with Jesus that you've been asking me to start for the last 2 years. I heard the word of God today and it sounded different, and I believe it." Not only is Messiah someone who's come to faith in Christ, but a man named Ray, who was invited, he and his wife and children were invited to come to worship from some of our members for months and months. And one Sunday they showed up, and they've come for the last 8 months, every single day. Ray said, "You know, those born-again people, they think they're the weirdest people in the world. Now I'm one of those weird born-again people, I believe. A man named David, a neighbor of mine, who's actually out here with Joe Sinagra at our booth here in the back, a guy that I've been sharing Jesus with for years and years and years and years in very, very dark places, 4 weeks ago called me up in desperation. And I said the exact same thing I've always said to him. But it was God's timing for him to hear and believe. And last Sunday, I baptized David in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit at the Christian Street Y, where we're now worshiping because we've outgrown our space. We've identified a property at 17th and Washington. It's an ideal spot for us for a number of reasons. We need approximately $250,000 for renovations, and we really believe God has led us there. We've been looking all over the place, and it's a perfect place that connects two different communities, south of Washington and north of Washington, kind of a hub where we could grow bigger, but then we could church plant ourselves like we've been planted, and that's really our desire. So I want to ask you if you would please do something. Would you please pray that God would abundantly provide for us? Would you pray that God would burden the hearts of His people so that the mission of the gospel would continue to go on, not only through us, but in us? God's been doing wonderful work in us and with us as well. So I want to encourage you to come see me after the service and reception hall here if you want to talk, and you can grab this information and find out more of what's going on with us. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for letting me be here. Almighty God, as we have already sung, we praise you, God, from whom all blessings flow. Lord, would you help us to hold loosely the resources you've given us so that we can contribute to the work that you're doing here at 10th and through 10th. And we pray that you would give wisdom, Father, to those that will make decisions with the money that you've entrusted to us, Lord. Help us to be wise and help us to be Jesus-centered with our decisions and help us to be cheerful in our giving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
take our Bibles and turn together to 2 Samuel chapter 6, the passage we read earlier today. "Is he safe?" asked the children when they heard the story of Aslan, the famous Lion of Narnia. "Safe?" came the reply. "Of course he's not safe, but he's good. He's the king, I tell you." Well, in many ways, that reply summarizes the lesson of this chapter that we're looking at today. Chapters 5 to 8 form a coherent section in the book of 2 Samuel. And what is significant about that section is the repetition of the personal name of God. Not one of his titles, like the Lord of hosts, but his personal name, I Am, or Yahweh, or Jehovah, is repeated over and over again, almost as many times as the name David is repeated, so the personal name of God is used to link God, the God of Israel, with David, his dear servant. And in this chapter that we're reading today, the phrase "before the Lord," that is, before I Am, or Yahweh, or Jehovah, is used four times, and I think pointing us to the main message of the section. Here is David, the Messiah. He is the Lord's anointed. The word anointed means Messiah. He's the Lord's anointed, God's earthly king, and he's taking the initiative to restore the fallen worship of Israel. Because during the reign of Saul, the worship of God has lapsed. In spite of occasional nods in the direction of the God of Israel, Saul has not been a king who has encouraged his subjects to worship God. And the great symbol, the kind of standing symbol of the decline of the worship of God in Israel, was the status of the Ark of the Covenant. Now, before we get too excited about the Ark itself is not a particularly significant-looking piece of furniture. Basically, it's a box with a lid, a box 3 1/4 feet by 2 1/4 by 2 1/4. It's not that much bigger than the kind of box you may have seen in your grandmother's house in which she stores her little knick-knacks, perhaps her linen, and perhaps a wedding dress or something significant from the past. Maybe you've gone in there and pulled things out and played dress-up when you were young. Talking to the girls and not the boys here, obviously. And the ark, although it's not significant in a fundamental sense, was covered with gold outside and in. It was very thin gold because you had to lift the thing, or the thing had to be lifted. And then on top of the ark, where the lid is, there were two cherubim, two angels, whose wings were curved inwards so that they kind of, the tips of the wings faced each other, leaving an exposed area beneath, which was the lid, or as it was better known, the mercy seat. And I'll come back to what that signified in a moment. The ark was normally housed in the Sanctus Sanctorum, that is, in the Holy of Holies, there in the tabernacle, hidden to human eyes by the great curtain that hung in the tabernacle and later on, of course, in the temple. And the ark served as a kind of rallying point for Israel. Let me illustrate it to you in a prayer that Moses prayed. You can read the prayer in Numbers chapter 10. But whenever the ark set out, as they were marching through the desert, whenever the ark set out, Moses would pray, "Arise, O Lord, and may your enemies be scattered, and let those who hate you flee before you." And when the ark rested, Moses prayed, "Return, O Lord, to the 10,000s of Israel." So here's Moses' prayer, "Arise, O Lord, return, O Lord," indicating that the ark symbolized the presence of God actively with his people. When the ark rose, God rose. When the ark returned, God returned. But here was the problem. Many, many years before, decades before this event, the ark of Israel had been taken into battle by the Israelites. Not so much driven by their faith that the Lord was going before them as their confidence that the ark
act as a kind of lucky charm, not the cereal that I enjoy so much, but the other kind of lucky charm, a kind of magical thing. Just having the ark with you would do the trick. It was like carrying around a little monument that you just, or a little object that was a sacred thing that you could take with you into battle, and God was sure to be on your side. Well, they took it into battle, and they were full of confidence in their ark as their lucky charm in the battle. But they lost the battle, and they lost the ark. And you know the story, if you've been following the series so far, you know the story. And previously in the story of Samuel, there was the episode where the ark is taken by the Philistines into their home city. And it's placed in the temple of their god, Dagon. And they put it on the shelf beside Dagon. And in the morning, Dagon's on the floor, face down before the ark of God. So they pick Dagon, their god, up, and they put him back on the shelf. And the next morning they go in to see, and there's Dagon on the floor, face down, headless and handless, before the ark of God. And the Philistines decide, we're not keeping this here, we'll send it to one of the other Philistine cities. And they send it there, and there are plagues. And they send it to the next one, and there are plagues. And round it goes, being passed from city to city, until eventually the Philistines get the message, we're not going to keep the ark of God in Philistia any longer. So they take it across the border, and they leave it there across the border in the home of Abinadab. And that's where it's been. Get here to chapter 6 of 2 Samuel, and it's been there for decades. Here is this essential, holy piece of furniture that belongs in the tabernacle of God. And for all of these years, it has not been used as an object to help people approach God. It has not been used in the way in which it was supposed to be used according to the law of Moses. It has stayed there in retirement, out of the way. Because the worship of God has declined. It is a standing symbol of the worship of God having gone into disrepair and God's people far from Him. Well, in this chapter, we come to a new day in the chapter of the new chapter in the story of Israel. A new day has dawned. It's like a new beginning. It's like a new creation of Israel. As under her Messiah, King David, the Ark of God is brought to Zion, which is to become the city of David, but also the city of God, the holy city. And here, at this moment in redemptive history, three things are brought together that are going to have monumental influence in the days to come. Three things which are going to belong together in the unfolding story of God in the Bible that will culminate in the arrival of God's Messiah with a capital M, uppercase letters. The Lord's anointed, together with the Lord's holy ark, and the Lord's city are brought together, prescient of what is going to come one day when the Messiah will be identified with what the ark symbolized and will be slain outside Zion's walls. And as a result of being slain outside Zion's walls, we'll inherit the heavenly Zion, about which we were singing, the heavenly Zion, which is the home of all of God's elect. Well, that's the symbol that we're looking at this morning. And the sidelining of the ark meant the sidelining of God. But now the ark's being brought back into the center. And there are three lessons that it teaches us about the presence of God, the holiness of God, and the mercy of God. First of all, there's the presence of God. And I want you to see that God is present above the ark, in the ark, and on the ark. God is present, first of all, above the ark. Because first of all, the ark represented the throne of God, which was above it. And the ark is the footstool of that throne. In fact, in 1 Chronicles 28, the ark is called the footstool of our God. You see, the God of Israel was never represented by any piece of furniture or by any idol or by any material thing. The God of Israel was an invisible God. You couldn't take him into battle. He could never fall off the shelf and be dismembered the way Dagon was, because the God of Israel is an invisible God. And he reigns upon an invisible throne. But what God did for Israel was that he gave them a visible thing, the ark, as a visible element of his reign, as a point, if you will, in which God, who is invisible, touches down on our planet. This is the place where God has said to Israel he will meet with his people. Yes, God is everywhere. God is everywhere present, but God is specially present where the ark is, because the ark is his earthly footstool of his eternal, invisible throne that is invisible to our eyes. And so here is all eternity. Here is the universe that God occupies in his glory. And the whole universe of God's glory is focused into this little spot of territory, the top of the ark that is his footstool, where he delights to meet with his people. And he represented this to Israel by giving them the Shekinah glory, the glory of God, the glory that led Israel through the desert. There was a cloud of fire by day, or a cloud by day and fire by night. So that wherever Israel was, wherever they parked, every evening, and they put their tents around the tabernacle in the middle, the tent in the middle, there the glory cloud of God would descend. And it would rest upon the Sanctus Sanctorum, the Holy of Holies. It would rest upon the Ark of God. God was visually, over 40 years, teaching Israel that the invisible God met with them at the tabernacle in the place where his glory touched earth. It is the throne of God it represents. Then you take over you open the lid. And in the ark there were some trinkets. There was the rod of Moses when he was confronting Pharaoh. You remember, he had this rod and the rod budded. Just a piece of pole. And it budded. God did a miracle through that rod. It was there in the ark. And there was a bowl of manna. You remember, for the 40 days in the wilderness, years in the wilderness, God was feeding his people with manna in the morning. And some of that manna was preserved and it was placed in the ark as a reminder of God's provision. But supremely in the ark, there were two tables of stone. And on those two tables of stone were written by the finger of God, the Word of God. For preeminently in the ark, there is the reminder that though God is invisible, God is not inaudible. Though you cannot see God, you can hear the God of the Bible. He is a speaking God. And there in the ark was the written constitution of Israel. There in the ark were the covenant documents of Israel, represented by the Ten Commandments written by the finger of God. And in those covenant documents was the basis of their religious and national life together. It's called the Ark of the Covenant because there were the visible elements of that relationship that God had with his people. So above the ark, his glory, in the ark, his word, and then on the ark. What was on top of the ark? Well, you say there was a lid. I've told you what the lid's name is, the mercy seat, the atonement cover. Because once a year on the Day of Atonement, the high priest, after he had slain the animals, would bring the blood of the animals in behind the curtain. Invisible to human eyes, he would go towards this ark of God, and on the top of the ark, on the atonement cover, on the mercy seat, he would sprinkle the blood of the animal that has been killed as a symbol that one had been sacrificed on behalf of the nation, of the people. that the blood had been shed, that the real judgment that Israel deserved had been carried out on an innocent other. And the blood is sprinkled on the ark to represent the real sacrifice that has been made for the people's sins. So David's interest, you see, in the return of the ark was a big deal. Here was the symbol of the ruling, speaking, pardoning God of Israel. And here's David the worshipper, summoning all of the people of God to bring the ark back and to place it at the center of the camp of Israel in this new capital that he was establishing there. But our interest, of course, in the ark is the relationship that David is establishing here between the Lord's anointed and the ark, because that ark and what it represents the work of the Messiah when he comes, ultimately. So, the ark proclaims the throne of God. And Jesus makes this clear when he reflects, you remember, on that vision that Isaiah had of the glory of God. He went into the temple in the year King Uzziah died. And there, coming from the Holy of Holies, where the Sanctus Sanctorum is, he saw the Lord high and lifted up, filling the temple with his glory and splendor. And Jesus said, referring to that incident, when Isaiah saw the glory of God in the temple, in the Holy of Holies, above the ark of God, Jesus said this, "Isaiah said these things because he saw my glory and spoke of me." We think of the glory of God, Jesus says, he spoke of me. You think of the throne of God, the God who reigns over all, and Jesus said, Isaiah was speaking of me. And then what about the Word of God? The Word of God in the ark. Jesus comes as the Word of God made flesh. The Father says from heaven, "This is my beloved Son, hear him." Jesus says, "Those that hear my words, they have life. I am the resurrection and the life." Thirdly, the ark proclaims the mercy of God. For there on the ark, you see, the blood was sprinkled that cleaned Israel for another year. And in the New Testament, Jesus is our priest and he is the sacrifice. He is the offerer and the offering. He is the one who comes and consecrates himself to God in that great high priestly prayer in John 17. "For their sakes, I consecrate myself." And then on the altar of Calvary, he offers himself as one sacrifice for sins for all time. He offers himself once to God as the Savior and Redeemer of his people. And it's on the basis of that that we are justified. We're made right with God by grace as a gift through the redemption price paid by our Lord Jesus Christ, whom God puts forward as a propitiation, as a sacrifice that turns away God's anger, and that is received by faith alone. So the ark, you see, is the symbol of the presence of God. It's a symbol of Jesus. It's a symbol of Christ centered among the praises of God's people. So when we ask the question this morning, how on earth do we have God-centered worship? The answer of 2 Samuel chapter 6 is you have the ark in the center. And the New Testament answer is what? It is you have Christ at the center. He is the one. He is the one who fulfills what the ark represents. He is the presence of God incarnate. Here is the Word made flesh. Here is God with us. In the tabernacle of his own humanity, he is present. Jesus, "Where'er thy people meet, there they behold your mercy seat." It's a picture of the presence of God. Secondly, in this chapter, we have the picture of the holiness of God. They were bringing back the ark, and do you notice the repetition of the fact that they carried the ark of God, verse 3, on a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab. This was a great event. It was an amazing event. They were all caffeined up as a result of this. Jonathan Olson, the whole The whole kin-caboodle of Israel were all hyped up at the very idea of bringing the ark back. David and all the house of Israel were celebrating before the Lord with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. Just sounds like a 10th worship service right there. So there they all are. Remember, it's not a worship service per se. It's worship and national event combined, because the church at this stage is a nation state. But they were full of joy. They were dancing for joy. This was participatory dancing for joy. Everybody was doing it. They were all in on the act. And then suddenly, in the midst of all this joy, suddenly, the dancing stops. The music stops playing. Suddenly, there's silence. Because we read in verses 6 and 7, "Then they came to the threshing floor of Nacon. Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, and God struck him down." It is a sobering word. Everything stopped. And maybe you're here this morning and this is shocking to you. Maybe it's offensive to you. Perhaps if you're not a Christian person, you think to yourself, "I thought you Christians talked about God being love and being kind and being slow to anger and being long-suffering." And you think to yourself, "What's going on here? After all, on the surface of the story, the man is only trying to stop this precious object fall to the ground and into the mud. You would think God would commend him rather than nuke him." But that's what happens. And I want to pause for a moment and say this to you. Nobody would have ever invented this story. If you were inventing a story about God that you wanted to be marketable in the 21st century, you don't invent a story about a God who goes about nuking people when they're doing what they're doing in good faith. It just doesn't compute, you see. The only reason this is in the Bible is that it happened this way, and we have to learn something from it. Because what's going on here? What is going on here is that Uzzah has forgotten the holiness of God. What do I mean? The Israelites have been given specific people to work in the tabernacle of God, priests who were descended from Levi, who are appropriately called Levites, because they were descended from Levi. And all priests were Levites, but not all Levites were priests. There were some who had specialist jobs. The sons of Kohath had a special job to take care of the sacred articles in the tabernacle. And there was a simple rule. The simple rule was this: no hands, no eyes, no vehicles. You can read about it for yourself. No eyes, you couldn't look on it. You weren't supposed to see the sacred furniture that was going to be in the Sanctus Sanctorum, the Holy of Holies. You weren't allowed to see it. You weren't allowed to touch it physically with your hand. You were not allowed, permitted to do that. And you were not allowed to put it on a vehicle and for a vehicle to carry it. In fact, there were gold loops on either side, four of them. And there were two long golden poles, and you could put the poles through the loops, and the sons of Kohath could lift it up and put it on their shoulder and carry it, but you weren't allowed to put it on a Lincoln or a Mercedes or anything else to get it from A to B. This wasn't permitted in the law of God. And there was a warning attached. You must not touch the holy things or you will die. You mustn't look in the holy things lest they die. God gives a warning. And all Israel knew about the warning. Now, why does God give warnings? He gives warnings for the same reason we do. We put the word poison on a can so that nobody will drink it. We put a sign, danger of death, where there are electrical works or something. Why do we do that? Because we know if somebody climbs over there and they get into that stuff and they touch it, all those bolts will go through them and they will die. You're supposed to respond. Die. Because they're in danger of death. And when God gives warnings, God gives warnings because there is danger of death. Now, as far as we know, and there's a dispute about this among the scholars, and it really doesn't matter either way, but as far as we know, Uzzah was a Kohathite and therefore knew exactly what his duties were. If he wasn't a Kohathite, he'd no time bother business being involved in the movement of it at all. But the likelihood is that he was a Kohathite and that he knew exactly what his duties were. He knew that touching the ark or looking at the ark or putting it on a cart was a capital offense. And yet what does he do? He touches it anyway. He sees it moving towards the ground and he reaches out to touch the ark of God. And it was a sin of arrogance and of presumption. See, what did he not know? What did this man not know? He didn't understand that the dirt and the mud of the ground have never, never offended God. The dirt and the mud of the ground is not unclean in the eyes of God. But fallen humanity is unclean in the eyes of God. All human beings, all of us, are unworthy to touch holy things because we are unholy. It is not the earth God condemns, it is people God condemns for our rebellion against Him and our offenses towards Him. You see, when it comes to the worship of God, we're not free to innovate. When it comes to the worship of God, we're not free to think we know the way to do it and go against what God has prescribed in the Bible. It's not a subject that you and I, it's above our pay grade to try and change the way in which God is to be worshipped. There's a Hebrew word that's used here, a root, that's used three times in these verses. And it's used in chapter 5, verse 20, when Yahweh breaks out against David's enemies and is called there the Lord of Outbreakings. And now in chapter 6, verse 8, David became angry because the Lord had broken out with an outbreak against Uzzah, so that the place is called Outbreak of Uzzah to this day. God had broken out. In chapter 5, verse 20, God breaks out against David's enemies, the Philistines. Here in chapter 6, verse 8, Yahweh breaks out against Israel, David's friends. Because God in His holiness is even-handed. God in His holiness does not prefer one to another. He doesn't prefer His own people to those who are pagan or outside of His kingdom. God's holiness is absolutely just, even-handed. Whatever you say about the God of the Bible, let me say this, He is absolutely not tame. He is absolutely not safe. He's not unpredictable. He is blisteringly, blindingly holy. He is a holy God. And yet that seems to escape, doesn't it? That seems to escape many Christian people today. We want a God who is manageable, God who's kind of fluffy, can sit on your lap and you can stroke Him. A God who jumps to your tune, a God who does what we want Him to do, a God who fits into our agenda and to our diary, our calendar. We want a God who meets our needs. We don't want the God who's there. The God who is rather scary. The God who is dangerous. But I want you to notice it doesn't end there. The chapter ends with the mercy of God. The mercy of God. John Calvin says this, "When God is terrible, it is not to make us frightened." David is frightened. You can see that. If you read the story, you'll find David is frightened by what he says. We're told in verse 9, David was afraid of the Lord that day. And he said, "How can the ark of the Lord come to me?" And so he leaves it. He leaves it where it is, in the home of Obed-Edom, a Gittite, that is a Philistine person who lived in Israel. He leaves the ark there, and for 3 months, nothing happens. David is, he's just kind of he's made immobile. He's immobilized by fear of what is going on here. And David is in the wrong to be immobilized by fear. He's in the wrong to be mobilized by fear. And God demonstrates this. You see how God demonstrates it? Verse 12. It was told King David, "The Lord has blessed the household of Obed-Edom and all that belongs to him because of the ark of God." For those 3 months, when David is immobilized by fear at what has happened, this bursting out of the holiness of God, what is going on? God blesses the household of a Gittite, a Philistine person, and his family. What is God saying? God is saying, "My holiness is not the last word. I delight to have mercy." David, instead of being afraid, apply to me for mercy. Instead of running away from me, come to me for mercy. Israel had been taught this from the earliest days. The God who judges delights to show mercy. Come to me for mercy. David has learned his lesson. And he gathers Israel together, and they went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom to the city of David with rejoicing. They carried him up, so Chronicles tells us, obeying the rules that were laid down, and this time within the rules God has laid down, there is uninhibited and confident joy. Because David knows what the problem was, solved the problem of disobedience, and now there is uninhibited joy in the presence of God as he brings the ark home. And Psalm 132 captures this event. Let's go to his dwelling place. Let's worship at his footstool, the ark. "Arise, O Lord, and go to your resting place, you and the ark of your might." The ark returns home. And in the midst of all this, you can see the elements of worship emerging. The elements of worship that day were obedience as they bring the ark back as it should be. And mixed with obedience is the posture of the king who humbles himself, the king who takes off his kingly robes and is dressed in an ephod, the ephod of a priest, and who joins with the people in bringing his sacrifice, his sacrifice of praises to God as they make their way. Obedience and reverence. Do you notice that along the way David pauses to offer sacrifices? Here is the priest king offering sacrifices of thanksgiving to God. In other words, here is David acting by faith here. No sin offering has been made, but he's offering thank offerings to God. He understands that the mercy of God is dependent on the work that is done on the mercy seat. And on the basis of the mercy seat, where sin is dealt with, finally, by God, he can offer up thank offerings to God. Just as today we come to God, we come on the basis of what's been done on the mercy seat of Calvary, where the blood of Jesus was poured out on our behalf. And on the basis of what Jesus did, we come to God today with our praises as our sacrifice of thanksgiving. And not only was there obedience and reverence, there was exuberant, joyful celebration of what God has done. Here you have Yahweh's self-giving. Here you have endless offerings being made as they stop. Every bit along the way, they keep stopping and offering sacrifices of praise. And then they will have communal meals. David sponsors all these communal meals so that all Israel is eating well and heartily in their celebration of what God has done. There's royal extravagance in it all. Exuberant worship of God. Well, not everybody is exuberant. David's wife, described as the daughter of Saul twice, in verse 16 and verse 20, is not happy. She is not a happy bunny. She isn't part of the celebration. Do you notice that? She's not part of the celebration. Look at verse 16. She looked out of the window and saw David leaping and dancing before the Lord, and she despised him in her heart. She doesn't identify with what's going on in the worship. like her father before her, apparently. She misses the wood for the tree. She doesn't seem to get the main thing. She doesn't seem to dwell on the right thing. She's diverted by secondary issues. She's looking at the behavior of the crowds and of her husband among the crowds, and she despises that. She doesn't feel any need to be part of what's going on. She is semi-detached. She is an observer at worship, not a participant in worship. And so David, at the end of the celebrations, goes home to bless his household, to gather the family and the servants together, to praise God and have a praise time in his own home with his own family. And he walks in the door, and there she is. Maybe some of you know what this feels like. He knows there's something wrong. And she doesn't wait to tell him what's wrong. How the king of Israel honored himself today, she says, with biting sarcasm. You looked glorious today, darling. Every bit like a king, not dancing around, cavorting in front of all those people like you were one of the boys today. Like you were one of the common herd. One of the masses. Where is your dignity? She's asking him. I understand exactly what's going on here. We came back from Canada, and in Canada we used to have long, hot summers. We came back to Scotland to rain every day. But then the second summer we were in Scotland, we had a heat wave. It was blisteringly hot. It was one of the hottest summers on record. I remember it well. It was a Wednesday. It came on a Wednesday. It left at Wednesday. But it was a warm day that day. And we look back to that summer with great affection. And so I decided that I would go down into the town in my shorts. They weren't short shorts. Nothing embarrassing. Nothing that you would be. But I went and I met one of the older members of the congregation. I remember it very well. He's in glory now, so I can tell you. His name was Hunter Henderson. And he and I became firm friends, actually, later. But this was the first encounter with Hunter. And he met me in the street, and I remember him looking me up and down. You could tell from his face what was coming. He looked at me up and down, and he said in his rather gruff Scottish voice, he said, "You might as well be naked." And of course, what he was meaning is, where is your grey suit and your clerical collar and all the things that make you look like the minister who leads the services on Sunday? If you don't look like a minister, I won't treat you like a minister. That is precisely what the daughter of Saul said to David that day. You don't look like a king. My dad knew how to look like a king. He looked every inch the king. He would never be found behaving as you're behaving, like you're one of the mob. David, in his witness to her, reminds her that actually in the presence of the king of Israel, he is only one of the crowd. And he reminds her that he is what he is by the grace of God and by the grace of God alone. God has chosen him to be the Lord's anointed. And he has his own bit of irony to throw in. Chose me rather than your father's household for this. But he goes on to witness well to her. He says this, "I have been celebrating before the Lord who chose me." In other words, I'm conscious not of your eye upon me, but of His eye upon me. Perhaps that's the best place for us to wind up today. When we come to worship, when we come to worship God, we come underneath His eye, who sees the heart. He sees what's in us. And when we come to God, we come through Jesus Christ, who combines within Himself the messianic office of the King, the role and symbolism of the Ark, in order that He might bring us to Zion, the city of David, which is the city of God. And in the meantime, He calls us to worship Him. Now that the new beginning has started, now that the ends of the ages have come upon us, He encourages us to worship God in obedience, with reverence, and exuberance to the praise of His glory. Let's pray. Father, we ask that by Your Holy Spirit we might offer joyful worship to You today, mindful not of the gaze of others, but of the eye of God. In Jesus' name, Amen. Now may the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Now let's go out to serve the world as those who know and love our Lord Jesus. God be with you.
Thank you.